recovery, and I'm going to let her explain that transition that's happening, which is awesome. But I heard Dr. Collier speak on executive functions, which is, of course, my passion, and she does a fabulous job with it, so I'm glad that you're here to participate. Welcome.
Thank you. I appreciate that. Wow. Is that too loud, or is that okay? That's good. Okay, great. Good. Well, thank you all for coming this morning. I really love to come over to Monarch. Just so you know, the Council on Recovery used to be the Council on Alcohol and Drugs. We just rebranded, which is fantastic because we don't have people who walk in the door primarily with alcohol and drug problems anymore. It's pretty interesting. We have people that come to work on process addictions, behavioral issues, mental health, and so we treat the wide variety of issues. So the council is right over on Memorial Drive in between Waugh and Shepherd, and we have another site in Austin as well, a residential treatment center that's just south of Austin called The Ranch. It's our residential treatment center. And so what my job is at the council, I do a few things. One is that I am over all the adolescent and treatment and fee-for-service prevention programming. And so we have a clinic that sees kids who are in the experimentation to misuse or maybe light abuse phase of engaging in high-risk behaviors. Most of it is alcohol and drugs, but a lot of the times it's technology addiction, gambling addiction, pornography addiction. These are ringing bells for you guys, right? Okay, good. Technology especially. And so then what I also do there is I oversee the Choices Prevention Program, which we have in 7 schools here in Houston. And then I also get to train the interns and fellows that we have coming in every year to our department. And so please let me preface this presentation by saying that I present to you executive functioning skills today, not necessarily based on my work with kids who have learning difficulties or autism, but pretty much my work based upon my experience and also working with kids who have substance use issues and high risk behavior problems. So these are pictures of me when I was grown up as a kid. Right? This is what I imagine my brain might have looked like at that time. But so this first picture of me, and I just love this picture, like it was before life changed me, right? You know, the innocence, you know, such an innocent, cute little kid sitting on the hill of Memorial Park with flowers blooming, you know. And then here I am, this next picture, age 12, is when I actually took my first drink of alcohol when I started. And so the average age of first use of alcohol today is, anybody want to guess? 10, you got it, very good. And she's like shocked because she was right, yeah. It's about 10, and then average age for first experimentation with marijuana today is about 11. But we anticipate that switching. More kids are using marijuana first now than alcohol. But where do kids get alcohol? Where do they find it? How do they try it first? Exactly, our house, our liquor cabinet. A lot of times we don't think, oh, I've got a few more years before I have to lock up my liquor, right? That's, but please, no. When they turn about 7, 8, that's when you need to start having a plan that is definitely put in place by the time they're 8 or 9 for keeping high-risk things out of reach of them, especially that. So by the time I was 16 years old, I had tried every substance under the sun and became an intravenous drug user and overdosed at the age of 18. This last picture here with this wonderful chunky chin and 1980s hair, right? was taken the day that I got out of rehab when I was 18 years old. I have on a t-shirt there, you can't see it, but it says drug-free body. And I'm doing this. I was so happy to be clean and sober. I had no idea that there was recovery. I didn't know any of that. And so when I went into treatment, it just really saved my life. And so my sobriety date is February 3rd, 1989. So I've been sober for a little while. And when I got back into college, because I had actually graduated a year early from high school, always a straight A kid, I took a year off to go to rehab and to go live in a sober living facility in a different state, and then I went back to school. And I could not shake the shame that I had about it. And so it really poured me into studying addiction. And that train of research led me into studying about adolescent brain development, which led me to study executive function. And so I'll share with you guys a little bit about kind of my story of through that as I share with you guys about executive functioning skills. So I started reading Lawrence Steinberg's research, who's a fantastic brain researcher, adolescent brain researcher. And his quote is my favorite quote above all. Isn't this so true that an adolescent has a well-developed accelerator, but only a partially developed brake? So we're going to talk about that today. The brake, the part of the brain that says no, is right here, our prefrontal cortex, our frontal lobes. The accelerator is right inside here, our limbic system, made up of lots of teeny tiny little organelles that are surrounded by this wonderful fatty tissue on those fatty lobes. And so as we move into adolescence, we start a new growth spurt. So let me just back up from there. By about age six, about five, six, seven, our brain has grown so much. You know how kids have sometimes huge heads, you know, and they're little in proportion to their body. I mean, their brain is really growing, creating that first layer of all these wonderful new cells. And we have about 200 billion neurons in our brain by the time we're about age six or seven. And then our brain slows down its growth for a while and allows our bodies to catch up, which is one of the reasons why kids really need to be very busy and active in between those ages. So 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 is hopefully the time when our kids are engaging in a lot of sports or activities or things like that, not sitting at home playing video games all the time, because their bodies need to grow and catch up. And then we hit puberty, and our brain goes through one last developmental stage. We don't think about that much because we see the effects of puberty happening. So we're focused in on all the hormonal changes and what's going on there, which most definitely affect parts of the brain and make parts of the brain more sensitive. But what we don't also realize is that the brain is going through, just beginning, a really important growth spurt that you guys as parents have a lot of say over how it gets created. So by the time we age to 24, 25, we actually end up with about 100 billion cells left over. So I know that I said the word growth, and it doesn't look like we're growing. Where it looks like we're actually, right, we're thinning out here. We actually start pruning away cells at about age 11, 12, and we end up with about 50% of the cells that we started with. But there are two very important things that are happening during this time that are the growth spurt, and here's one of them. So this is a really huge picture of a neuron, a brain cell. What you've got is your cell body, your axon, and then these wonderful dendrite things at the end that kind of look like broccoli to me, like little tree roots. And so you've got this substance called myelin that is surrounding the axon. That's the fatty tissue, myelin. And so what's happening in between about age 11 and 25 is that myelin is starting to thicken. And what I learned about myelin is that it is a great conductor of electricity. And so as the myelin thickens, the electrical impulse that's moving down the axon goes faster and faster and faster, the thicker the myelin. But our brain needs room for this myelin to thicken, for it to grow. And so that's one of the reasons why it starts to prune away cells. Another thing that's happening is that we are growing more of these dendrites. So a dendrite actually reaches out to a new cell and makes a connection. It actually doesn't touch the new cell, but it does create a synaptic site where it can communicate with the next cell. And it's interesting because we grow these and they end up looking like trees, Like, so one neuron can end up looking like a tree with millions of branches of dendrites coming from even one cell. It's amazing. And so, and again, in order to make room for all these connections, what we see is a pruning away of the cells that we don't need. Now, the thicker the myelin, the faster processor you are. So how fast you think really depends upon the myelination of your cells. And so what we learned about this is that processing speed peaks at the age of 25. And then it's kind of slowly downhill from there, right? As you guys are, anybody over the age of 25 in here experiencing that? Okay, good. Yeah, you guys know. And so Deborah and I were just talking about this earlier, the memory, right? I live in one of those three-story townhomes, and I'll get to the very top and go, oh, why did I come up here, right? And then I think, okay, my processing speed is about on a 15-second delay, right? Isn't it? And then if you just wait 15 seconds and do something else, oh, that's what I came up here for, right? And so we see that delay growing as we age. So we want our kids to peak at the age of 25, right? We want them to be really fast, efficient processors, as much as they possibly can be. Okay, so here's my fun analogy that I love to give kids, okay? You guys, so when you're teaching your kids this, you can use the car analogy. This is the only car analogy, actually, I use. When my husband starts using them, I'm like, what? What do you mean? It's like God gives us what's going to be a car right here in our frontal lobes. We don't know what kind of make, what model it's going to be. We have no idea, but we get all the parts to it that we're ever going to need and we're never going to need, right? So we just get this wide variety of cells in there. And then when we hit age 11, 12, we start putting those parts of the car together, the parts that we like, the parts that we use. And then, hopefully, by the time we're 24, 25 years old, we have a fast, efficient processing machine in there, right? Anybody know what kind of car this is? Oh, wow, great. Okay, everybody woke up feeling like a Ferrari in there this morning? Not until you had your Starbucks? No? Still no? Okay. So, that's the analogy. Here's what it really looks like. So you can see that we do have a frontal lobe at about age 5. It's there, it's just not very developed. By the time we're 8, it looks really similar, hasn't grown very much. Now, the darker the color, the less gray matter, so that shows you that we're, you know, losing cells. But you can see by age 11, 12, the thickening process is really in full force. And so you can see the frontal lobe. It goes about halfway up our skull, right behind our forehead. And so by the time we're about 20 to 25, it starts to be really thick with myelin and really well connected with long strings of neuronal chains. It's interesting because it actually doesn't look like a chain. It's actually compacted into small little places. If you really, really have an interest in this, there's a fantastic YouTube video called You Are Your Connectome. I highly recommend it if you love listening to things about the brain. And our connectome is really how our brain cells are connected. It's interesting, if you were to kind of map out all of your connections on a flat map, what you'd see is it looks like the map of the United States. There are places in our brains where there's huge connections of cells that look like cities, and then all these long chains that reach out to small little connections that look like tiny towns. It's really interesting, and it's called our connectome, and everyone's is different. Our environment shapes what gets connected. Okay, so remember, myelination and increased connectivity. Now, there's not a whole heck we can do to make sure that our kids' brains become myelinated, other than making sure that they still stay healthy and well-fed and well-nourished and hydrated. But there is a lot that you guys can do as parents to make sure that your kids increase their connectivity in certain areas of thought. So let's talk about what is in your power and control. The use it or lose it principle is so crucial, you guys, to know as a parent. The lessons that you are, sometimes it feels like futilely teaching your kids, they're getting in, one dendrite at a time. You may not see it right away, but they're there. So think about the term scaffolding. I have this feeling all of you know what that is as applied to learning, right? So scaffolding, if you think about scaffolding around a building, you'll have, you know, the first layer and that builds in the second and the second. And, you know, you can't get way up there until you get the first one. So this is, you know, a theory of learning, scaffolding. And so we have to have that first layer, and then we build on top of that. Same type of thing with connectivity. We need a few brain cells connected for something simple, and then we can go on to something bigger and bigger and bigger. All governed by what our kids are using. Okay, so that's why it's important to provide them with lots of rich experiences, which is wonderful that you guys are able to bring your kids here to the Monarch School. Right? The Monarch School knows about executive function. I mean, that is what they're doing every day, all day, right? They're providing your children with lots of rich experiences so that their brains can create long strings of neuronal functioning for these skills. You can do this work, and you already do, at home. And what I'm hoping to do is just give you a few more skills today that will build upon this. You know, one of the things that drive me a little nuts about some of the other schools that are out there in the world, you know, we have all these great charter school ideas that are popping up everywhere. I don't know if you ever read Malcolm Gladwell, but he wrote a lot about the KIPP Academy, and then there's Yes Prep, and there's all these wonderful schools that are filling gaps out there for kids who need it. But some of the things that they leave out in order to make it affordable are things like music, sports, drama. They don't get to do those things. A lot of those schools, the main goal is to get a college admissions test filled out, right? That you get into college. If a child has done that, then the school is deemed a successful outcome. And yes, that is a successful outcome. However, when you think about brain science, you think, oh my gosh, you know, there's a lot of kids that are going to those schools who may not necessarily be naturally wired for just academics. And so we're not giving them such rich variety of experiences for our kids to figure out what they like and start to create new cells for. So, but we can do that for our kids at home. Now, here is what your frontal lobe does. Now, please know that this is not an exhaustive list. There are other executive functioning skills within the umbrella of frontal lobe. However, and let me show you, I actually printed this slide because so you don't have to take notes on this. So I'll go ahead and here, let me give you one since you're up front. Sure, please stay. Thanks, Deborah. Yes, interactive, multi-sensory, most definitely. Rich experiences, I think of also a variety of them as well, right? So when I think about a school, I think I want them to have the opportunity to engage in a lot of different types of activities. And even within the academic hat, there's a lot of ways that you can provide rich experiences in that, right? If you've seen some really great math teachers who do experiential exercises with kids to teach math, right? I mean, we have so many different ways of learning. So I'm a therapist by trade, and when patients come to my office, when I'm assessing them, of course I assess for all the kind of normal things that you'd look at in a person's life, trauma, mental health, behavior, but then I also want to figure out what kind of a learner are they? Are they very tactile? You know, do they need to touch something or feel something to learn it? Those are the clients I get up and do a lot of experiential exercises with. I have tons of toys in my office, and I always tell everybody, it's for my clients, but my staff think it's really for me. But or they might be a real auditory, you know, learner. And so if I get up and draw things on the board, it'll drive them nuts. They just really want to hear it. You know, or they're a visual learner, and then I will use the board. So we really want to figure out each person's different, what their learning style is, and then offer a good variety of experiences. Okay, so here are the executive functioning skills that I picked out, because to me, if you can do these things, you're probably going to be a fully self-supporting adult, don't you think? Right? Okay, so let's go through each one of them, and then I'll talk a little bit more about how we utilize those and how you might be able to. So this first one, abstract conceptual understanding. And so when we're really young, we think in very concrete, abstract terms, right? And so very concrete, meaning if things are black and white, there's not a lot of gray. And you know, when we're young, it doesn't need to be gray, right? It just needs to be kind of all or nothing, black or white. And so what we hope is that our kids will move into abstract conceptual understanding so they can see the gray. And here's one of the reasons why that's so important. If you think about all the rules there are in the world, isn't there an exception to every one of them? There is, right? And teaching your kids that is sometimes really challenging, right? Because they're thinking very concretely, all or nothing, yes or no. And so, well, no, in this situation, within this context, the answer could be yes. Oh, that's difficult information to understand if you're a concrete thinker. So what we want to try to do is teach abstraction, conceptual understanding. So a conceptual understanding is being able to understand and think about something that you can't see, feel, or touch. One of the examples I always use is the idea of love. So, you know, to an 8-year-old girl, you know, love is the feeling that they have for mom, dad, grandma, you know, not brother, sister, but, you know, right? Exactly, sometimes. But to a 16-year-old girl or boy, love could be a color. You know, it's more than just an emotion. It might be a whole list of behaviors. It could be this concept that you can't see, feel, or touch that transcends meaning. It could be poetry. It could be a song, right? I mean, it turns into something bigger, deeper, and more meaningful. Another great example is religion, the idea of God. You know, when we're really young and we're concrete thinkers, we think about maybe praying to a man in a white robe. You know, we go to church and we see the cross and we see it as a very black and white, all or nothing kind of concept. And then when we get older and we realize, wow, there are a lot of different religions out there and people have a lot of different ideas of what God is. Maybe you could even create your own understanding of a higher power. And so that's a good example of how we can move into abstract thought about things. The next one, you guys, is impulse control. So this is the one that I actually spend most of my day working on with kids and parents. So I do a lot of parent consults. I'll have parents come in and say, "Can you believe they did that?" And I'm like, "Oh yeah, I totally can." What? What do you mean? Okay, so for instance, I had a parent this week who has a 15-year-old child who did something really stupid and is paying some big consequences for it. And she says, "Can you believe this?" And I said, "Well, yeah, because at age 15, they probably have about 45% frontal lobe, which means they only have about 45% impulse control, right? And when the impulse is there, the limbic system, that part of the brain that is all or nothing thinker, is in control, not really the frontal lobe." And so this child is interesting because they feel very guilty and remorseful and they know that they did something stupid. But when you ask this child, "Why did you do it?" What's their answer? "I don't know." And we get so frustrated with that, right? But what's the truth? They don't know. Because it was an impulse. There was no thought to it. because there's just no connection there, or there's just a very minimal connection. And so if we think about what our frontal lobe does for the rest of our brain, is it is the brake. Scientists say that it gives us top-down control. Top-down control. And so the limbic system, all those internal little teeny tiny organelles where the amygdala is and the nucleus accumbens, all these little organelles that govern novelty seeking and emotional responses, those act on their own all the time. They're very reactive. But it's the frontal lobe that talks back to it and says, ah, no, don't do that. It's not a good idea. But if our frontal lobes are not very well developed yet, then we're going to have limited top-down control. So the next couple, problem solving and decision making. We want our kids to have long strings of neuronal connections for problem solving and decision making. But let's compare. When you're little, your problem solving and decision making consists of going to mom and say, Mom, can I do this? Yes or no? Right, that's it. It's very concrete. But as we grow up and start developing autonomy, we start being able to analyze solutions, possible solutions. And it usually starts with brainstorming. Brainstorming is an incredibly important skill when solving problems, isn't it? Think about, is there somebody cute over here? Hi. I was like, I'm losing all of your attention. It's hard to compete with cuteness like that, right? Yeah. So, okay, if you're an adult, you first start problem solving with brainstorming. Where can I go for this information? How can I gather lots of different ideas? And so if you've ever been involved in an actual scripted brainstorming exercise, if you might remember, it starts with you being able to think of anything you can possibly think of, no matter how stupid or silly. Now, if you let go of judgment and containment of ideas to real life solutions, then it narrows your focus. But if you let that go and you just start brainstorming on lots of different ideas, your brain will really run crazy with all kinds of ideas, and it may actually lead to something that's really new and creative. Is it still happening? No, okay. They're over there. Okay, then, as an adult, once you've done your brainstorming and you think, oh, those are a couple good ideas, then you think of the pros and cons of each solution. You list them in your mind, right? Sometimes we may write them out, doing a pros and cons list. And then what we do is we choose one, of course, that has more pros than cons. Unless you're an adolescent, you may choose something different. And then you implement the solution, but then it's not done. Once you've done that, you turn back around and you evaluate the outcome. How did it go? And you tweak it. This is a many-layered step of problem solving and decision making. So think of scaffolding, right? The first thing being brainstorming. The second level being the pros and cons, and on and on and on. We can teach this to our kids if we go one layer at a time. And think about neuronal strings. You want long strings of neurons for each one of those layers. Now, all of this, hopefully, will result in our kids' brains having very good judgment about things. And then here, emotion regulation and frustration tolerance. These are two huge prefrontal cortex skills, aren't they? Oh, they are. So we can't grow up and continue to have temper tantrums. Even though I know you guys know some adults who still do, right? We still do at times. You know, it may look a little bit different, but we still do. We have to regulate emotions and tolerate the frustrations of everyday living. And we can develop long strings of neurons for these skills. I like to kind of think about my frontal lobe as my inner parent. Freud might call it the superego. And then my limbic system, the part of the brain that wants, fight or flight, as my inner child, right? And so it's my inner parent voice that I really want to strengthen. And it's really amazing because my inner parent voice can sound a lot like my mother's voice or father's voice, right? So remember that, because that gets integrated into their mind. Okay, this one, you guys, the ability to feel empathy. Okay, this one to me is huge. And if you don't get the other ones, but you get that one, I think you might still be okay in life. Right? Because what do we call the people in our society and culture who cannot or do not feel empathy? Psychopaths, sociopaths, psychopaths, exactly. And where do we hope they go? Far away from us, jail, prison, right? And so empathy is something that is so vital to human connectedness and relationships. But always remember, you guys, you need this first one before you can achieve empathy. So think about what empathy is. Empathy is the ability to step inside somebody else's shoes and imagine what it might be like to not only feel what they're feeling, but maybe even think what they're thinking in a situation that you may never have gone through. That takes abstraction. The ability to abstract. And this is why a lot of kids that don't have abstract conceptual understanding don't look very empathic. It has nothing to do with their quality of being, which is what I think as parents sometimes scares us, right? Yeah. It really has a lot to do more with their frontal lobe capacity. But we can strengthen this. Okay, then we have working memory and planning, right? These are things that we hold in very dear as adults, right? Our working memory is the ability to have kind of floaters, I call them floaters in the air, all these memory or idea bubbles that are up here that are floating, and then I'm thinking about them, and then I can consolidate and bring one down. It's really interesting because our working memory it has about 7 bits of information. And so we can hold about 7 bits of data in our working memory at any given time. And before we decide to actually encode it into our long-term memory via the short-term and so forth. And so this is why that once phone numbers went past 7 digits, it became more difficult to memorize them. Because our working memory only has 7 parking spots, so to speak. I actually went to, many, many years ago, a presentation about this, about kind of leadership, success, that kind of thing. And it was so interesting because the person who led it asked us all to think about what was in our junk drawers. I thought, what does this have to do with it? And so a lot of times we keep projects that are on hold or little bits and pieces of things that we think we might need in our junk drawers. And do we ever need them? Usually not. But they take up a lot of space that could be used for something else. And I just loved that analogy because the more clean your junk drawer is, it's interesting, if you actually clean out that drawer, or if you go through your desk and you just finally decide, you know what, I'm just never gonna do this project, gone. It frees up areas in your brain that can be used for something else. So working memory, though, is something that can be increased in adolescence with the use it or lose it principle, planning as well. And think about planning. When you plan something, you need foresight, right? You need to be able to think, oh, well, if I do this, then this. So if then scenarios, if then this. If this happens, we'll do this. If that happens, we'll do this and come up with plan A, B, C, D. So adults usually have a pretty good sense of planning and they have long strings of neurons, especially if they've experienced a lot and if they're good at it, then they can usually think of lots of different scenarios. But what if you're a very concrete, all or nothing linear thinker, right? Then planning is what am I want to do next? The 1 to 2 steps. So we usually want to increase these strings in our kids. So here are all the executive functioning skills. And they are all based upon use it or lose it. All of them. The executive functions are what make up what we call psychosocial maturity. Psychosocial maturity. And that is governed by the use it or lose it. So one of the ways that we increase these skills at the council where I work is we play the executive function game. And so I have a class called the high risk class. And kids who pop positive on random drug tests at their schools, they get sent to us at the council. We do an assessment on them, and we usually refer a lot of them to the class. So I have the parents in one group down the hall, and then a bunch of kids in the teen group with, I've got high school interns and then two therapists who are usually in the group. And what they do is they split the room in half, kind of like we are here, and your team A, your team B. And if you, during our discussion of whatever we're talking about, can demonstrate one of these executive functioning skills, then you get a point for your team. And if you hear one of your teammates talking using one of these skills, then you can point that out in your team member and you get 2 points. Okay, so you see how we're using this. If you, anybody know B.F. Skinner? I mean, remember B.F. Skinner? Classic behaviorism, right? Back in the 1950s and 60s, he created the rat lab. Well, I actually took rat lab twice, once in my undergrad and once in my master's program, and I learned how to shape human and animal behavior by training a rat to press a bar 50 times for one sugar pellet. And so what happens when you add positive reinforcement to a behavior? The behavior goes up. It just does. What is one of the most powerful positive reinforcers that we can give humans? Love, definitely. But actually, if we think about love in verbally, praise. Praise. You know, a lot of times our kids know they love that we love them. And that's a given. You're my mom. You're supposed to love me. You're supposed to say that. Right? But we get really worried and anxious a lot about our kids' futures, don't we? And that worry and anxiety can take us 5 to 10 years away because we actually have good frontal lobe ability, right? We're planners. We're thinkers. We know about potential consequences. But then, unfortunately, that takes us out of the moment, being right here and right now sometimes with our kids, when we could actually positively reinforce for these skills. Now, what I make up is that you guys are well-versed, actually, at doing this a lot, maybe more so than a lot of parents that I might speak to in other venues. But maybe not, I don't know. What I'd like you to do is utilize these skills, these words, in your everyday parenting language. By praising and positively reinforcing them, knowing that the use it or lose it principle right now is on your side. When your child's brain is about 25 years old, it's going to be done growing. Now, that doesn't mean they can't learn. We can learn for the rest of our lives because our dendrites continue to grow. But the myelination, how quickly we think, our processing speed, how connected our brains are, is for the most part grown, peaked at the age of 25. So we still have a long way to go. And we can increase these skills by thinking about and using them in our daily language. So let me give you an example of what that might sound like. So every day that I'm working with kids, I might hear them say something about what's going on at school. And I'll say, wow, I really like the way you're thinking about this. That's really like a big picture way of looking at it. I'm positively reinforcing abstract conceptual understanding. I might say to a kid, oh my God, you know what? Last week, you wouldn't have been able to say no to that. But this week, you did. You like walked away from that kid when he offered you whatever. How did you do that? So So when I do that, I'm positively reinforcing impulse control, decision making, and abstractual conceptual understanding. I might say, oh my God, that was a really great decision. Tell me how you came to it. I'm positively reinforcing decision making and abstractual conceptual understanding. You know what? You handled that tolerance today better than I've, or that frustration today better than I've ever seen you handle it. You tolerated that frustrating experience. Oh my God, your friend was being so annoying, but you stayed really calm. How did you do that? I'm positively reinforcing frustration tolerance, emotion regulation, and abstract conceptual understanding. Now, there's a few words that are key here. When I ask a kid to tell me how they did it, how they solved a problem, how they handled a frustration, what they were thinking, I'm asking them to go back in time abstractually, conceptually, remembering the incident and what their thought process was. Now, what you'll usually get is kids will say what?
I don't know.
It's one of the most frustrating things as a parent, right? As a therapist too, because then you feel like a dentist, right? Like pulling information out of, right? And so adolescent therapists, I think especially, get really, really good at asking open-ended questions. So what I usually do too is I will make up stuff to get them to argue with me about something like, oh, you feel really happy today. No, I do not feel happy. And, you know, if I'd have just said, how do you feel today?
I don't know.
Right, you know. Exactly, just, you know, because they want to argue, right? One of the reasons, you guys, why kids want to argue so much is actually you're looking at it. Their frontal lobes are growing. Their frontal lobes are exploding with growth. And one of the ways that they build new dendrites is by arguing with you. Doesn't this make you feel better about it? I know, right? So when parents come in like, oh, I'm so frustrated. They're always arguing. We're always in a power struggle. I'm like, this is great news. Because that means they're developmentally right on target. When you see arguing, that's a good sign. Now, the trick to this is not to bite on what I call power struggle worms. You guys know what a power struggle worm is, right? It's this big, juicy worm on a big hook. And as soon as we bite, who's in charge of us? The kid, right? We're in. So the key is not to power struggle back. The key is also not to lecture, not to make everything a teaching moment, right? You have about a 30-second window of time when they're actually really hearing you. And once you go past 30 seconds, now your voice sounds like, wah, 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 right? It is. They just, ugh. It was really interesting. So in my parent group on Monday night, we had a parent in the group who said, you know what, not a parent, one of my counselors in training who's worked with kids, and he said that he'd done a group with a group of 17-year-old boys at a boys' school, and that one of the boys said, you know, I really wish I could tell my mom more, but every time that I tell her what's going on with me, I get this like 15-minute lecture. It's like everything's a teaching moment. I don't want that. I just want to tell her what's going on with me. To me, that's a really beautiful lesson for us, right? And so actually, what you're kind of learning today might be able to help you talk to your kids differently. And really, the talking should be about 10% of the time. There's a 90-10 rule. They should talk 90%, you should talk 10. I know you're thinking, my kid never talks at all. How do I get to this ratio? Well, part of the trick is for you to shut up, right? Part of it is what I call duct tape therapy. You guys know what duct tape therapy is, right? It's imagining a big piece of duct tape going where? On your mouth, exactly, right? But what you can do is think about this list and create really wonderful open-ended questions. How did you solve that problem? Oh my God, this is a huge problem. What are you gonna do? oh, that's so frustrating. How are you going to handle this situation? Instead of us wanting to jump in and do it for them, right? So one of the things that I see in my practice, when kids come in for an assessment, I like to meet with the whole family first. And I'll usually look straight at the kid first and say, tell me why you're here. And so it's so funny. I usually get like three different responses or types of responses. One is the kid just starts talking to me and telling me all this, usually lots of BS and lots of this, and you know, but from their perspective, and they're talking and talking and talking. The other response is they look at mom. They look at mom. They don't say anything. They don't answer, but they look at mom. And then mom does what? Starts talking, right? The third response is that the kid starts talking and then mom interrupts because it's bullshit, pardon me, or they're wrong, it's not that way, or you know, and they're correcting right away. The response that scares me the most is the one where the kid looks at the parent, because that tells me we have a lazy talker, because mom does it for them. Now, I realize that some kids, especially kids who have learning difficulties or speech difficulties, there's a reason for that. However, doing the talking for them is extremely dangerous, because instead of creating long strings of neurons for talking, for thinking about what to say, they're creating long strings of neurons for dependency on you. And that will generalize to dependency on whomever else. So while we have this window of time between 11 and 25, use it or lose it is on our side. We want to try to get them to use as many neurons as they can, so they will create long strings of complex myelinated connections for those skills. So with that particular mom, I might ask her and teach her to do some duct tape therapy and to stop. And now another thing too is parents will say to me, but what they say when they talk is completely irrational. Do you guys hear that too? Right? So I have to do what? If they're irrational, what do I have to do as a parent? Correct them, teach them. No, you don't. The best thing to do with irrational thoughts as a parent is to parrot them back. Literally, you guys, parrot them back. Can anybody think of a good irrational thought they heard their kids say lately? Oh, I'm never going to make friends here. Now, what we usually want to say, especially that one, because, oh, God, but that's not true. If you just give it time, if it right, we launch into that. The best thing actually to say is look back at them and say, oh my God, you don't think you're ever going to make friends here. Now, do you see what happens? If a couple things happen. One, they get to hear their own irrational thought out loud. And kids can actually tell irrational thoughts from rational ones. They really can. And then what might happen is they'll argue with you about that. Well, you know, because they just heard it. It's really interesting how when kids have a mirror to the irrational thought, it like bounces back and they start to think about it, process it in a different way. If there's no mirror and it just gets absorbed into the mommy soothing tub, it doesn't get processed in that way. It does get positively reinforced, though. The I'm never gonna thought, the irrational thought, right, gets positively reinforced with all this wonderful mommy attention. So we're reinforcing the irrational thought, because along with that irrational thought is a feeling, right, that goes with that. For the kid, it's, you know, rejection, fear, and for us, huge fear. Sometimes we can handle being rejected, but when our kids are rejected, doesn't that send you into mama bear mode so quickly, right? When your kid's rejected or your kid's in trouble. But it's unfortunate because if we react, if we parent based upon those feelings, it's usually the wrong parenting move. Usually. Not all the time, but usually. Okay. So, think about using this language. I like how you planned this. Tell me how you did it. Wow, the way you're thinking about this, it looked like you had a lot of things in your memory. That's really cool. Tell me what those things were. I really like it when you tolerate frustration this way. Tell me how you did that. The three words, tell me more, are the golden phrase of parenting. Tell me more. Tell me how. You're asking them to go inside their brain and figure out how they did it. Now, you may hear them say, I don't know, a million times, but please, please, please do not let that keep you from continuing to ask, tell me how you did it. Because eventually, they'll answer. And then, when they answer, then you can say, wow, that was great thinking. I love how you thought like that. You're reinforcing this cognitive connections. And praise, I promise you guys, more than cell phones, more than peers, your praise, your kids will work for more than anything. And, you know, one of the things, especially for me, when I get to meet people, they're usually coming to me because the kid's in major trouble. They've engaged in some sort of high-risk behavior. And so validating language, executive function, reinforcing language is usually what? Non-existent. Because they're angry, they're really upset, right? They're worried about money or they're worried about future issues. And so the ratio goes down. So let me mention one thing about ratio and then we'll go on. So ratio of communication is so important, and here's how important it is. Anybody heard of the Gottmans from Seattle? And relationships, exactly. Two psychotherapists together in a marriage who do couples counseling, and they created a fantastic, a huge therapy based upon their studies. What they did was they built this huge apartment in Seattle, and they had couples come and live in the apartment for 2 or 3 days at a time, and they videotaped all their communication. They did this for 30 years. 672 couples lived in this place. Isn't that amazing? Longitudinal study? Wow. And then they stopped the study and went back and started coding all of the communication. And then they looked at, okay, like who stayed married and who got divorced? And the people who stayed married, what'd they do? How can we learn from them? And they found out a lot of different things. I encourage you to read some of their books. But one of the major things that they did is universal to every relationship. They found out that the ratio of positive to negative communication in the couples who stayed married was 5 to 1. For every one negative thing that was said in that marriage, there were 5 positives. That's a pretty big ratio, isn't it? And the positives can be really simple things like, I love you, how are you, hugs, you know, just lots of more positives than negative. And it's interesting because they actually replicated this study in other venues like corporate and school, and they found the same thing, that the best teachers have the best ratios communication-wise. Now, the couples who got divorced, anybody want to guess what their ratio was? The other way, right? Completely reversed? We think so. It's interesting because the couples who got divorced actually had more positive to negative 2, but their ratio was 1 to 0.9. And so for every negative thing that was said, there was a little bit more positive said. But it's almost equal. And we can't live that way. Human beings just don't thrive in that kind of an environment. Isn't that interesting? And so they found at school that, you know, the teachers who were the worst teachers had ratios like that. Students don't learn from them. The bosses who had have that negative ratio, don't maintain employees. It, what's interesting in the corporate world is they found that people will stay in dead-end jobs, pay-wise, for decades if they have a boss like this. Right? That relationship will sustain happily for a long time. Same thing in parenting. Think about these skills and that ratio. And think about that when you use that 5-to-1, great problem solving, good impulse control, I like the way you're thinking, wow, that was good planning, blah, 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 instead of just saying great job. There's some great books about that communication. But when you just say great job, you are reinforcing what? Nothing. Well, performance, general performance. And then we create performance anxiety, right? But if you are positively reinforcing skills, you're actually increasing skills. Daily language. Okay, have I made this point enough? Okay, good. So let me share with you a study. It gives you a little bit of a difference between IQ and EQ. And so there is a difference between intellectual ability and psychosocial maturity. And by the way, how much time do I have? Am I going till 10? An hour? You know, nobody knows. I'm just going to keep you here for a few hours then. Okay, no, just kidding. I'll stop at 10. Okay, so when you actually do, let's say, a functional MRI on someone who's taking an IQ test, you will see all parts of their brain light up. All parts of the brain light up. Because we're using all the parts together, very integratedly. But when you do a functional MRI on somebody who's doing maturity tests, problem solving, decision making, working memory, empathy, it's their frontal lobe that lights up. Two different processes here. So we call psychosocial maturity EQ, your emotional quotient, right? Your fluid intelligence, your street smarts. And so there's a great, lots of studies, but one study in particular that saw the difference between these two was a driving study that was done. Scientists compared adult drivers to teenage drivers. So who do you guys think is a better driver, adults or teens? We all say adults, right? Because of course we're better drivers. Their insurance is so darn high. But what they found is by the age of 16, teenagers are equally as good of drivers as adults. And I'm thinking, well, then I'm glad we give them licenses at this age, right? Woo, phew. They actually will drive very well. If you put them in a car by themselves, they will use their turn signal and their seatbelts, and they'll keep the radio down, and they're good drivers, equally as good as we are. And so actually driving is a really good indicator of intelligence, of IQ. And what we see, the trajectory of IQ, is that starting at about age 10, it starts to really go up. We gain lots of IQ points in middle school, early adolescence. We get to about age 16, our IQ is almost as high as it will ever be because our IQ also peaks at the age of 25. But we're almost there by the time we're 16, 17 years old. Now let's go back to the driving test. What happens when you put peers in the car?
Oi.
Okay, well, so if I drove with you, would it change the way you drove? It doesn't. So when you put peers in the car with adults, it doesn't change how we drive. Now, if it's my mother-in-law, you know, I might change a little bit, but for the most part. Now, when you put peers in the car with teenagers, what happens? All hell breaks loose. Where's the seatbelt? The rolling through stop signs. What happens to the music? Right? Okay. So what we find is that psychosocial maturity, right, and the level of that stays really flat. It's interesting. We have a little bump at about 16, 17. I think this is when they're starting to drive. And then all of a sudden, droop, goes down a little bit. We get to about 18, 19, and it starts to go up. You guys, what happens at 18, 19 that all of a sudden our psychosocial maturity is starting to go up? We go off to college, hopefully, right? We leave home. You guys, think about use it or lose it. Think about use it or lose it, right? We're starting to have to use these skills, and they're starting to shoot up. What's interesting is our EQ, our psychosocial maturity, also peaks at about the age of 25. Now, you can see the problem. Do you see this big gap right here? That's why I call this slide my mind the gap slide. Because if you have, let's say, a 17-year-old kiddo, they have an IQ that is almost as high as yours. And don't they know it? Right? Yes. And yet, they have an EQ, about 10. Oh! So we have a huge gap. Now, this drives me a little nuts because this is a conglomeration of data that was collected in the United States. Can you imagine what this chart might look like if it were collected in a country where kids had to grow up a lot faster? What would it look like? The gap would be much smaller. There's always a gap because our frontal lobes don't finish growing until 25. This is frontal lobe, right? However, the use it or lose it principle is at work here. And so what we'd probably see is a gap that looked much more like this. But what we see in this little blip right here, I think when our kids get too much independence, we're like, whoa, you know, and we start doing more for them maybe than we should do. And this chart really demonstrates kind of the use it or lose it principle right here. And so if we apply the use it or lose it principle to our everyday life language, I think that we can increase this bottom line and decrease the gap. But we're still going to live in the gap for a while. Okay, so what part of the brain do they use if their PFC is not formed? This is important, I think, to remember. We have really hit home what the PFC does, but you also have to remember that what they're thinking with until their PFC is completely grown and mature is their limbic system. Their limbic system is actually fully online and mature by the age 11, 12. Fully mature. The limbic system is in blue right here, 3D image. It shows you all the little organelles that create our limbic system. It really is all about fight or flight and survival. There's a little organelle in here called the amygdala, and it's right there at the base of our limbic system. Our amygdala is very, very important for us. It's like a switch, an on or off switch. It's triggered by fear and anger. Fear that we might not get something we want. Anger that we're not getting it maybe. But it goes back a long, long ways. So where there's a fear response, something happening in our environment that threatens us, the amygdala will turn on. It sits right next to the pituitary gland. It tells our body to give us a shot of adrenaline, which rushes blood to our hands, to our feet, and to our eyes, and gets us ready to fight, flight, or freeze. And then what's really interesting is when we are in that limbic state, here's what our brain looks like. This is a functional MRI looking down upon the brain. So we've got the eyes looking out this direction. And when somebody is calm, cool, and collected, all parts of the brain have blood flowing. That's what the colors represent, is blood flow, electrical activity. The darker the color, like the red, the more the blood is there. But when somebody is in fear or they're in angry state, this is what their brain might look like. You notice that all the blood flow and electrical activity is moved out of our frontal lobes into our limbic system. This is why when we're really, really angry, then we don't respond very well. We have a hard time thinking, right? Because our frontal lobes are off. I'll tell you a quick funny story. I love brownies, chocolate brownies. They're like my favorite dessert, or chocolate cake. And so I brought a big chocolate cake home from Kroger's, and that's like all I wanted for dinner was just chocolate cake and milk. And I was happy with that. I'm an adult. I can do that, right? And so my husband comes home, he's like, that is not what you're going to eat for dinner. And I had this huge piece of cake, you know, on the plate. So he grabs the chocolate cake and he just pulls it away from me. So you guys, I was really hungry, so that I didn't have enough frontal lobe juice going on there to maintain top-down control. And so I got so angry, so quick, like snapped. And I looked around the kitchen to figure out, like, I don't know what I was trying to figure out. But I grabbed a cell phone. It was the first thing that I saw. And I went to the sink and I turned on the faucet. And he was like, "Crystal, what are you doing?" And then all of a sudden I was like, "Oh, Crystal, what are you doing?" So here's what happened. I went limbic, literally fight, flight, or freeze. And I was like, what am I doing? I mean, that happens to us. We get that angry and upset. There's kind of a point of no return, you know, like we can handle it and frustrate tolerate the frustrations up until this point when we go limbic, right? And so now whenever we have this long running joke about, I'm like, don't touch my chocolate. You know what happens. It'd have been scary if there was a knife or something that, you know, like, whoa, my God, what, you know, we can be very, very impulsive. But so what we want to do is to remember that as our children are growing their PFCs, they're still run a lot by their limbic system, which means fear and anger can turn that on quickly. And it has an off switch effect on the PFC. So we want to, here's one last study I'll share with you about reading body language. So Deborah, I know it's 10. Can I keep going? I just have a few more minutes. Is that all right? Okay. So they did a fantastic study about reading body language. And what they found is that when adolescents are reading body language, the area of their brain where there's the most blood flow is there in the amygdala. And when adults read body language, they do so with their prefrontal cortex. And so until our prefrontal cortex grows and comes online, we're using our limbic system to guide us in the world. This is why kids misread our body language easily. And remember, if you have a child who has a learning difficulty, then their psychosocial maturity is delayed. So you may have a 17-year-old kid who's still functioning at a 12 or 13-year-old level, which means their frontal lobes are delayed a little bit in growing and analyzing while their limbic systems are fully grown and reading the world. And this is why sometimes you may say something completely innocuous and your kid's like, "Why are you mad at me?" And you're like, "I'm not mad. What's going on?" But because their limbic system, their amygdala, is reading you, they only have two choices. You're scared or you're angry. Right? And then they will react based upon that. So something you can do to help with that is to go to them and say, "I want you to know that I'm not angry, but I am irritated." Like, you can come to them first and help them label emotional responses by staying calm. So apply the tools today. I want to show you a picture here, the use it or lose it. There we go. Fun. Use it or lose it principle in action. Here is a real picture of a neuron. One little baby neuron here. And you can see all the wonderful axon and lots of dendrites. And now if we look at a bunch of them together, you can see how they reach out to the next cell. This is in an infant's brain. And then as we move up into about 6 months of age, you can see more neurons. And you can see how the dendrites and the neurons actually get nice and thick as they grow. And look at these wonderful dendrites reaching out to other cells. And look at how that thickens. We learn when these new dendrites reach out. And so every time that you say to your kid, "Wow, I love the way you solved that problem. Tell me how you did it." And they start to tell you how they did it, even if it sounds really irrational. Remember, they're growing those new dendrites. Every time they talk about that, every time they use an executive function skill, every time that you positively reinforce it, that's what's happening. They're growing new dendrites, one dendrite at a time, reaching out to the next, and to the next. So one thing we also have got going for us is that our brain has a lot of plasticity during adolescence. It is the most plastic up until the age of 25. What that means is the world shapes our brain. It can heal. I know, isn't this funny? So, neurons, they're really fickle. They'll connect to each other one day, but if you don't use that trek, what happens is those dendrites actually break off. And then new dendrites will grow and reach out to other cells and create a new track. The example I always give is, you know, one of the reasons why I drank and used and engaged in high-risk behavior as a kid is because I had family problems and really low self-esteem and a parent who had abandoned us when I was really little. And so I always had this thought that I was bad, that I was not worthwhile. And I did a lot of behaviors that validated that negative core thought. And I had long strings of neurons in my brain for that negative core thought. And then as I got into recovery and I started to heal and I went to therapy and I used those silly little positive affirmations, you know, like I'm smart enough, I'm good enough, and doggone it, people like me. I've got Stuart Smalley fans in the house. So the more that I kept saying that to myself and saying that to myself, there was one day that I actually woke up and went, oh, my first thought was I'm good enough. It was a really cool moment. I used to go to this meeting on Friday nights and I'd walk into the room and I'd look around and I'd see, okay, who are the cool people here? And oh my gosh, can I sit by them? Is somebody going to save me a seat? Who's going to ask me to go fellowship afterward? All this insecurity. And then all of a sudden I had this shift in my brain. And I noticed that the next time I went to that meeting, it was like, hey, I wonder who's here. Ooh, I don't like that energy. Oh, hey, I like this person. Let me go sit. Let me go see what they're going to do. Let me ask them. Oh my God, I don't have the insecurity. The thought's not there. So we can replace, right, old negative thoughts by not sending any blood flow or electrical activity down them and create new pathways with new dendrites. But it's one dendrite at a time, right? So that could take a long time. So move from amygdala thinking into prefrontal cortex thinking. Use your handouts to help you remember. And if you would like a copy of this slide, right, Train Your Brain, right, that's got a lot of the great references, if you're interested in reading that good stuff, please feel free to either email Deborah or me. I'd be glad to send it to you if you'd like it. Any questions in closing? Great. Yes.
And so it's really affecting his schoolwork. And my cousin keeps telling me I'm being helicoptered by trying to, you know. And so I'm wondering what is, you know, to help that executive function develop. How do I help him to get there?
Sure. Doing it for him. But see, ooh, that's a bad choice. Ooh. Okay, solve it for me. That's what I choose, right? If somebody said that to me, solve it or solve it for me. Okay, you. You go. Right? So that's the, think about the scaffolding, right? What level do we need to do first? Right? The level is he comes home. Okay, what do we need to do first to plan for tomorrow? Lots of open-ended questions. What's the first step? Okay, what's the second step? Oh my God, what a great idea. I like the way you're thinking. Let's keep going. You remember when, you know, we potty train them and all of a sudden they went and you're like, it's a party. That, oh gosh. That's how I want you to be when he figures out an awesome first step and a second step. You lavish all that attention on him then, right? And so that he does it. And then do your best not to rescue, to face natural consequences. So if he forgets a test or he forgets homework and he gets a bad grade, to actually sit down and say, okay, let's go back through and think about when you forgot. When do you think that you forgot it? Have him go back abstractly to the night before or this before. And then, how did it feel when you realized you forgot it? And what did the teacher say when you forgot it? And how did, so slowing down time for him right? And having him go back through abstractly and remembering that moment. Now I'm like posing for the camera. Remembering that moment. And then being very careful that your 5-to-1 ratio is about the things that he is doing well, little by little by little. So, you know, instead of helicoptering over him, sitting next to him and saying, okay, I'm not doing this for you, but you're not going to get up from this table until you figured out how to plan for tomorrow. And when you figure out steps 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, I'm going to positively reinforce the heck out of you for you figuring that out. Great job. But then when you do have a consequence, let him face the natural consequence. Don't run up and give the homework, you know, to them, because they need to struggle. You guys, struggling is so awesome for kids, but we rescue them from it so much. Think about what happens when you struggle. You create long strings of dendrites for not struggling anymore, right? For self-soothing, for calming yourself down, for learning how to handle guilt and shame, right? And natural consequences. I know moms are like, oh, this is so uncomfortable thinking about my kids struggling. But these are really great skills that our kids need to have. This is so uncomfortable. having long strings of dendrites for all those skills, we are robbing them of the opportunity to create those dendrite connections if we don't let them struggle and go through that. Did that help a little? Okay, great. It's so hard for us. Any more questions? No, come on, more. Yeah, that was good. Did you like it? Did you like the presentation? Okay. Okay, good. Thanks. Thank you. Let me know if I can do anything else to help you guys. Okay. Cool.